Well, extraordinary week this week in the Middle East. Joining us now to discuss that escalating conflict and the extraordinary pages slash blowing up phones, etc., etc., attacks against Hezbollah, former British commander, great friend of the show, Richard Kemp, Colonel Richard Kemp. Richard, great to see you. You're in Washington, I gather. What, just tell us, really fascinated by the military side, the complexity of the pager attack. So these pages blew up with Hezbollah. They were pages that only went to Hezbollah operatives. They blew up, killed several, injured many more. Tell us about the military side of this attack from your point of view, Richard.
Yeah, good to be with you. This is a very devastating attack against Hezbollah, and it's probably about the most carefully focused attack you could ever launch against a terrorist organization, because it's targeted on individuals who are members of the Hezbollah terrorist organization. It's incredibly sophisticated work by, presumably by Israeli intelligence, although they haven't acknowledged that it was them that did it. I think most people assume that it was. And it's not only does it do real damage to Hezbollah, and I'm talking about destroying their communication system to all intents and purposes with both pagers and also walkie-talkies, but also killing probably quite a large number of Hamas operatives, including senior ones, and wounding, severely wounding, many, many others. Very damaging to Hezbollah, and also deeply humiliating to Hezbollah. Across the Middle East, there has been Hezbollah has been ridiculed by on social media and in some mainstream media for failing to have the level of security needed to be weak enough to allow Israel to carry out this operation. So a very, very serious attack against Hezbollah, which could have strategic consequences.
James.
Well, you know, along with that, we've now seen the walkie-talkies exploded, and now they've hit Hamas operatives meeting to talk about what to do. This would seem to be, there'd be other benefits as well, and I'd love to hear your thoughts on this. Number one, I imagine that this would be psychologically hugely crippling to Hezbollah and their operatives, who would now be just, you know, completely paranoid because they don't know where the next thing that's going to literally explode on them is. But also, it seems they'd have a huge intelligence trove now on, you know, who is in Hezbollah, who these people are, everybody who went to the hospital. They've got information now on everybody who's now linked at the level where they'd be getting one of these pagers. Could you speak to that a bit?
Yeah, when there's such a massive security breach as this was, any organization that suffers from it immediately wants to carry out investigations to find out who was responsible. Because, of course, if they're still active within the organization, which they probably are, then they could do even more damage. And so it becomes critical. And that in itself is a crippling operation where everyone's under suspicion, or many people are under suspicion. And they don't, as you just said, they don't literally don't know which way to turn in terms, you know, can they use their mobile phones? Can they use their electric toothbrushes? Can they use computers? Is there a risk in all of this stuff? So it's very, very psychologically damaging to them.
Rita.
I'm interested in your response to the commentary we've heard since this attack was took place. A lot of politicians even, we've got a Green senators here, including Marine Faruqi, saying this was just an unacceptable act. A lot of people are calling it an act of terror, essentially. Is that how you see it? I would have thought targeting Hezbollah operatives was as far away as from terrorism as you could possibly get. They weren't targeting regular folk, but there is a lot of commentary that this was an indiscriminate attack and innocent people were caught up in it.
Yeah, because everything Israel does is wrong.
Glad you cleared that one up for us, Richard. Now I understand what I've been misreading. Yeah, thank you, Richard. Excellent. Good.
That's what Senator Marine Faruqi meant.
That's what
everything
meant,
Israel does.
You nailed it there, Richard. Carry on.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Israel carries out an attack in Gaza to kill terrorists hiding behind human shields, and tragically, uninvolved civilians sometimes die, despite the precautions that the IDF take. And then, so that's wrong, because it risks civilian death. Then when Israel carries out a really pinpoint attack like this. Okay, there may have been one or two people killed who shouldn't have been killed in this attack, but that happens in war, and it's not terrorism. This is not a terrorist attack. It's the most, probably most precise anti-terrorist attack you could carry out. Mm. And Israel is perfectly entitled to target those people who have been firing rockets into Israel, more than 8,000 rockets since the 8th of October, firing rockets almost every day into Israel. Why shouldn't they carry these attacks?
And Richard, just you mentioned that, so surely now we can expect to see, you know, tell us what the war goals are. Netanyahu said the goal is to get those people who had to move out of northern Israel because of those rocket attacks you've mentioned. Can they now go back in? Is Israel going to focus on Hezbollah now finishing off the job? Will we see Israeli troops moving into Lebanon, or are they now going to refocus on Hamas? What do you think the strategy is going forward in the next few weeks?
Well, Hamas have been largely defeated in Gaza. They're still there. There's still terrorist acts taking place inside Gaza by the remnants of Hamas, but they've been largely defeated, and that means that the IDF now are able to move reinforcements out of Gaza to the northern front. And we have seen, in fact, we've seen today, we've seen devastating attacks by Israel against Hezbollah in Beirut and elsewhere, killing large numbers of terrorists, destroying rocket launchers, preempting what the IDF believed was a planned, major planned attack against Israel. So they preempted that. But we have seen this evening, I'm not sure how that relates to the time zone that you're in or I'm in and the time zone in Israel, but today, shall we say, today or yesterday, we've seen very, very significant barrage of rockets fired out of Lebanon, about 120 rockets reportedly, going deep into Israel, some of them not actually hitting Haifa, which is further south than Hezbollah's been seriously attacking recently, not actually hitting Haifa, but hitting a lot of places nearby Haifa. So it's a real move, it's a real change, I think, in Hezbollah's actions. It shows that they are, you know, they're really reeling from what's happened. I'm sure of those 120, most of them will have been intercepted by Iron Dome and other air defence systems, but there may well have been, and literally the reports are coming in now about this, there may well have been a number of Israeli casualties. There's been quite widespread fires caused in northern Israel by some of these rockets that have landed in probably mainly in open or forested areas.
James.
Well, what are the chances then now with these two Iranian proxies, Hamas and Hezbollah, seriously weakened and disorganized, that Iran itself decides to step back into this and escalate the conflict to basically avenge their proxies or buy them some time to keep the pressure on Israel? I can't see them just simply letting these two fronts fade back.
Yeah, you're right. And although, as I just said, Hamas have been largely defeated, not totally destroyed, but largely defeated, a major proxy of Iran. And now with Hezbollah under serious pressure in the north, Iran may well be tempted to wage it itself and carry out maybe a similar kind of barrage of rocket attacks as it did on the 14th of April. And you can be sure, I know for sure, that Arab countries like Jordan are ready to intercept Iranian rockets coming from either from Iran itself or from the Houthis in Yemen. And I'm sure also, I don't know this for certain, but I'd be surprised if allied air forces like the US Air Force and the Royal Air Force are not also already preparing themselves to help defend Israel. Israel's focus is clearly on the north, but it has to protect itself throughout the whole country as well. And as we saw on the 14th of April, its allies, I hope, will come to its aid and try and minimise the damage that's being done by Iran and its proxies. But I think we are, I didn't really answer Rowan's question properly earlier. I think we are getting close to the point where Israel may feel now it's the time to carry out a major offensive into southern Lebanon to push, to destroy parts of Hezbollah there and push the remnants back up north where they're not presenting quite such a threat, and thereby allowing the 60 to 80,000 Israeli citizens who've been evacuated for about a year now to go back to their homes.
Richard Kemp, fantastic always chatting to you. Enjoy your time there in Washington, and we'll chat again soon. Thanks so much for your insights.